Hello, this is Paul Ricci. Okay, I'm here for my second interview I've done for Allegheny Independent Media. Our website is still a work in progress, but I thought I'd start off with our logo, and then I will give you a brief introduction to our guest, Barb Zablotny. She is the 2018 Ms. Wheelchair Pennsylvania, and we're going to talk about disability issues. So I do have this brief keynote address she gave at a graduation of the Commonwealth Technical Institute.
Which is actually a really great question because I'm even still wondering that. My name is Barb Zablotny. I was born and raised in this area. I wasn't born with a physical disability, but I did struggle with dyslexia, but never realized it until about 8 years ago. School was always hard for me because of that. I still wanted to be a veterinarian though. After getting into Penn State, I realized learning in a university setting was definitely not for me. Over 100 people in one class while you sat in an auditorium and took notes in your lap. I decided to change my major to veterinary technology and become a certified veterinary technician. I found what I thought was an amazing school in Scranton called Johnson College that offered what seemed to be an amazing veterinary technology program. The setting at Johnson College was much better with smaller classes and more one-on-one time with the teachers. If you were struggling, they offer free tutoring, which I took advantage of often.
Okay, well, that was just a brief introduction. I figure we'd rather talk to her, see what's going on today.
Be sure to check out the YouTube channel to listen to the rest
Yes.
if you're interested.
Yes, she does have her own. What was the name of your?
Rolling Rainbow Barb.
Okay, yes. So yes, she has lots of videos. Lots of good ones. I guess this might be one she might want to add.
Yes.
So, okay, now I'm going to stop sharing the screen. And okay, so I guess maybe we'll start off. I guess so, like you said, you were studying to be a veterinary technician.
Yes. So as you heard in that keynote speech, I was studying to be a certified veterinary technician, which involves about 2 years of schooling. It's different from a vet assistant. A lot of times people get the two confused. I kind of equate it to being a certified veterinary technician is equal to like an RN, and a vet assistant is pretty much like a CNA then. So, both important jobs, but they're different kind of training.
But then your plans got upended.
Yes. So, I was involved in a motor vehicle accident with a 5 week internship left. Before I could get my degree. And I just hit a patch of black ice, lost control of my vehicle, and was paralyzed on impact due to not wearing a seatbelt. So please wear your seatbelt if you're watching this. I am prime example of why you should. And at that point, you don't get disabled or acquire a disability and just know your rights. And just how society was overall, especially during that time frame, you just didn't really think much about disability. We were still going to public schools with disabled students being segregated from the rest of the students. So that's what I was, living in. So now I acquire disability. I don't know my rights. And essentially the college told me I could not finish it because the AVMA, the American Veterinary Medical Association, requires the students to be able to have a certified veterinary technician, diploma, to have a week of surgery, X amount of hours of surgery time, and I would be a patient risk, because I couldn't be sterile in the surgery suite. They are correct about that. There were ways to do it, but it was beyond my, price point. But it was something that they weren't necessarily wrong in saying that.
And so my OVR counselor at the time, Office of Vocational Rehabilitation counselor, looked into it, and he felt that at that time, he didn't feel it was discrimination, but rather it was just a job I couldn't do. So while it really sucked and I just didn't want to accept it, it was what it was.
Yeah.
And it was a few years after that, I heard that a student, maybe 2 years after me, she had cancer and was going through cancer treatments of radiation. And she also was a patient risk and couldn't be in surgery, but they gave her the reasonable accommodation of working behind the desk instead. And I was never given that option. I asked for that option and they just told me that there was just no way. So it was at that moment I realized I was actually discriminated against. And, you know, I was, that was a hard lesson to learn. And that was kind of what really lit a fire for me to start becoming an advocate more and speaking up and wanting to learn more about disability rights and my rights and other people's rights. So.
Okay. Yes, I do see that, you know, I mean, you know, I guess the issues might be different. I mean, like some people might argue, I guess that other person with cancer, I mean, she was still ambulatory.
Doesn't matter. Because, you know, she still was a patient risk, so she couldn't be in the surgery suite regardless, you know. What you're kind of saying, essentially, if someone says that that's a form of ableism, you know, because she has a disability too, but it's a disability that people are properly educated on. And a lot of people just think, oh, because they're non-ambulatory, they can't do anything. But we can do things, but the environment is not conducive for us to do things, even though it's written into law, federal law, for the environment to be accessible to us to do these things. So it's kind of a ableism happening within society and not really realizing it. And it took me a while to realize that, like, my own internalized ableism. And that's kind of what the college did. So, you know, I could have sat behind a desk doing paperwork just like she did. You know, my arms work. My brain, everything, you know, my legs just didn't work. And she was sitting just the same. So, you know, I was still able to do examinations. I was still able to do blood work. I was still able to, you know, do radiology. I was still able to do a lot of things. And they just discounted me.
Okay. But obviously this led you down to the path to advocating for disabilities, which is good. I know that, you know, sometimes people have a one size fits all mentality about disabilities or trying to accommodate them. But, you know, certainly the issues for a quadriplegic are different from a paraplegic, might be different from someone with autism or.
Yep. You're correct.
So yes, I mean, and trying to accommodate them all, it's still a challenge, and you know, it still takes a lot of effort to try to get people to realize the issues. I mean,
just follow a federal law. That's kind of, you know, if they follow the federal law, they will be pretty close to, you know, accommodating the majority of us.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen, even around here in Johnstown, there's lots, I mean, just wanting to go out to a bar with friends, that could be a challenge.
Yeah.
Because many bars are not, they're not wheelchair accessible.
No, so, you know, so when it comes to, I guess, my advocacy, and when it comes to accessibility to, like, businesses like that, I was raised in a small business family. My brother owns a small business, you know, like we,
the chiropractor.
Yeah. So I understand that, you know, this, let's say a local bar is not accessible. And for them to become like, I'm looking at it and there's like a flight of stairs or something, you know, something that I know logically is going to cost them a lot of money. I kind of just let it go because I understand that that could potentially be, you know, ballet lessons for their child or that, you know, and I don't necessarily at that point it is what it is. They just won't get my disabled dollars. And yeah. That's fine. You know, if they're willing to accommodate, like a lot of businesses, you know, some of them I may patronize and they're willing to make an accommodation by bringing it out to the car. Now curbside pickup is more of a normal thing. Back before the pandemic, that wasn't a normal thing, but businesses were still doing it for disabled folk. So, you know, now that it's more, it has a name, curbside pickup, you know, it helps a little bit to make the world more accessible for those of us with a disability when it comes to these small businesses that may not be accessible. And I kind of ultimately want to blame the Pennsylvania legislation the way it is, making it harder for small businesses to become accessible. Like, you know, a place like, for instance, in California, you know, that place, the everywhere out there is pretty much accessible. Things are just a lot different out here as it comes to legislation with disability stuff. So it makes it a little bit harder for small businesses to afford to make accommodations.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. I mean, certainly that's a challenge. And so, I mean the long term, you know, it has been, say, almost about 30 years since they passed.
32.
Huh?
32, just last week.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And, you know, I guess, you know, it's not, I mean, still enforcement is not universal.
Pretty much the only way to enforce it, and a lot of disabled people don't know this. I hear it often. Is, you know, why is no one enforcing the ADA? People need to enforce the ADA. Well, I hate to break it to everyone. It's up to us to enforce it. Mm-hmm. That means us going into litigation a lot of times, having conversations, giving them, you know, practical solutions. And if they aren't willing to work with us and you know that this is completely wrong, just, you know, like, let's say a medical facility or a park or a public, wherever taxpayer dollars are going, it by law has to be accessible under multiple laws, not just the ADA. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to that stuff, it's a little bit different. And I'm more like, this needs to be fixed. It's been 32 years. There's no excuse here. This is taxpayer dollars. Fix it. So, you know, it's up to disabled people to be the ones to enforcing these laws. Sadly, there's no police officer enforcing it. So,
sometimes it could lead to like expensive litigation.
A lot of times, disability lawyers will listen to your situation and, you know, they'll decide if it's worth, you know, the money and time they're going to be putting into the litigation. But typically you don't need to pay money up front if you have a good case, at least. Because they get paid afterwards. The Supreme Court just ruled in April of this year that under the Rehabilitation Act, disabled people are no longer eligible for any type of damages that they may have sustained at a medical facility as a result of discrimination and inaccessibility. Really? So yeah, no one talked about that, but it happened at the end of April, and Cummings versus Premier Rehab was the name of that. And as a result, disabled people don't get compensation for lawsuits. We get accessibility.
Mm-hmm. So these things they're not enforced like, say, health department codes or for restaurants or, you know.
Not really, no. I've had several run-ins with our local law or our local code enforcement. Mm-hmm. And I've caught them not thoroughly doing their jobs at several different businesses locally. So even the code enforcement isn't always. So the thing with the code enforcement is, say this place was built in, let's just say 1988.
Mm-hmm.
So they have to abide by 1988 code. And now if they did a renovation since then that moves things. So like, say this place was never touched since 1988. I can't go and go to the code enforcement officer saying they're violating codes because by what they have, they are adhering to this code. And this is what I was told by the code enforcement in our region.
Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes I know, like, for other types of discrimination, you know, they do have things like the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. I mean, the federal government to try to enforce, you know, to try to assist in enforcement, but there's nothing like that at the federal or state level.
So you can go ahead and file a complaint with the Department of Justice. I know several people who have, and nothing has really come from it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is that meaning they didn't do anything? It's hard to say. Like, we don't know what I guess could happen. But that was the experience that I have, you know, I have heard. So maybe I'll do it one of these days and see what happens. But that is what kind of exists as the Department of Justice. You can go to their website, and there is a place to file, you know, a non-compliance or a discrimination claim.
Yeah, but I guess sometimes it can take a while for them to respond to it.
Yep. And I pretty much learned quickly that no one's coming to save me and no one's coming to help me. And it's up to me to fight for myself is kind of what I've learned at this point.
Did you ever wish you had, like, when you were in that veterinary tech program, do you ever wish you had sued to try to?
Yeah, part of me, like, had I known my rights like I know them today, I don't doubt that I probably would have pursued that a little bit more. It was a private college.
Yeah.
So I don't know how far I would have gotten because of it being a private college, because essentially private colleges can do whatever they want. So I'm not entirely sure where it would have gone. But a part of me wishes I would have understood my rights a lot better to kind of push on it more. And my experience now is a lot of these places just don't understand. Like, I didn't know. So how am I supposed to expect able-bodied people to know? Right? Like, they don't.
Yeah.
So it essentially, I have to be the one educating them, and I have to be educating them with facts in a rational way. Because a lot of times early on, I was reacting out of emotion because, I mean, I'm being discriminated against. It's hurtful.
Yeah.
So you have to get control of your emotions, and you have to level, you know, and talk with them and educate from a neutral standpoint and kind of explain to them where they're violating things, and you have to really break it down for them. And a lot of times when you do that, you do get somewhere. If they are reasonable. Now, some places are unreasonable, I will tell you that they are. Or you'll get the runaround and you'll never get to the person you should be talking to about it. You'll get, you know, every manager and supervisor, but never the person that can make the change. So you'll get that scenario too. But a lot of times when you break things down and you tell them, you know, section whatever of the ADA, and you explain things that way, you will sometimes get somewhere. And that's kind of what I've learned, is I have to control my emotions and I have to come from a place of just education. And I need to realize I might not be able to get into this place. It's fine. It is what it is. But you know what? Let me educate them. Maybe people after me can at least go then. And that's what being an advocate's about. It's not really about me. It's about everyone else. And I'm aware of a problem that's affecting a lot of people who are too oppressed, weak, tired, exhausted, you know, dealing with their own disabilities, dealing with their own situations to put up a fight. And they don't know their rights either. So they just deal with it.
And
they just think this is the way it's supposed to be.
Yeah, I know some of them have to live on Social Security disability. And, you know, I have worked with lots of physical and intellectual disabled, and you know, I do notice that even like the term, I found out like recently that some of them hate the term handicapped.
Yep, don't say that. I'm so, more offended by that than most terms. That term.
Yeah. Because the term originally meant holding out your hand with a cat for money.
Yep.
It is,
you know, it is not a, you know, good term, but it's funny because people are like, well, what are we supposed to say then? And I'm like, accessible parking, accessible bathrooms, wheelchair parking, wheelchair bathrooms, you know, whatever. Just don't say handicap, you know. And a lot of people, again, just they don't understand the damage that words can cause sometimes either. Mm-hmm. I personally have, again, learned to just not get too offended by words. But when you learn the origin of words, like I personally, so a lot of people will think that the word cripple is a very offensive word. And I personally don't find it offensive in the slightest.
Yeah.
Now, that's not speaking for all disabled people, but I personally don't find it that offensive. But I find handicapped 20 times more offensive than cripple could ever be. So, and people are usually shocked by that. And I'm like, well, look up the definition of cripple in the dictionary. I do not have use of my limbs. It defines what is happening. So why would I be offended? And there's no real, when you look it up, there's no real backstory, like the whole handicap route and stuff. Like there's no real backstory as to why cripples necessarily seem derogatory other than that's what people once referred to. And so there's been a movement of disabled people wanting to take the term cripple back as a term of empowerment.
Yeah, I guess the term, maybe handicap might be fine if you're talking about golf.
Yeah, yes.
So that doesn't offend you if you're talking about golf, but
yeah, it's all context.
I do know that, you know, like in England, you know, they don't use the term mental retardation anymore. You know, though, I guess they use the term learning disabled. Mm-hmm. But I mean, here, learning disabled refers to you know, people with dyslexia or ADHD.
Yep.
And, you know, so here we use intellectually disabled. I mean, I never heard how people in England might respond to that, but, you know, it might be interesting, but
I think it's important to know, you know, if you're traveling somewhere, it's important to kind of look up and understand the cultural differences as you, you know, when you travel. Because I know I watched something recently that in Dubai, if you say the word disabled, it's like illegal, and they call them, like, you know, people with disabilities, they call, like, there's another term for them that's like supposed to be more positive or whatever, but you know, apparently they like fine people, and disabled's a bad word in Dubai, and to the disability community in America, it's not. It's what we are. So just say the word, you know. And a lot of people are like, oh, is it okay to say disabled? And it's like, yeah, that's what we are.
Yeah, I mean, you need some way to define it.
Yeah, it's, I'm like, I think even when I look back, when I newly got injured and whatnot, I never was upset by that term. It never triggered nothing ever. It was a neutral word to me. It was like, okay, yeah, now I have a disability. Now what, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of, it's all about perceptions and context and understanding those different cultural differences too, and respecting each country's cultures as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. I mean, you know, I guess I know, like, some people, I mean, probably the last thing most disabled people want from others is pity.
Yes. We have a term, a slogan in the disability community called piss on pity. There's actually a movie, with that title. We do not want your pity, but we want to be treated with equity and to be, you know, listen to us and make things accessible. Like, your pity is not helping me at all.
Mm-hmm.
You're nothing to help me, so, or anyone. Like, what am I going to do, turn it in for, you know, brownie points? Like, I don't know. So I personally don't look for pity. I don't want pity. When I tell my story, I want people to understand gratitude maybe a little bit better. I want them to understand that tomorrow can change in the blink of an eye beyond any reason of their own. No one is guaranteed their abilities from minute to minute. The abilities you have now could be gone any minute. And everyone is just temporarily abled until, because if you live long enough, you're going to have a disability, whether temporary or long-term. This is something that affects everyone. Okay. And we need to, you know, make sure the world is accessible for everyone.
Yes, I understand. Yeah, I mean, that's, yeah, I guess the, I mean, yes, I have struggled with some of the learning disabilities in school. And, you know, I guess in some ways those issues are harder because it's not easy to see.
Yep.
Compared to physical disabilities.
I have dyslexia, so I completely agree with that. It is a different scenario of trying to, I guess, get validation for what you're going through. But knowing that there's ways now, again, to be accommodated for learning disabilities with technology, I mean, it's just, it's amazing. Technology has been the best thing for disabled folk to get better accommodations and to get things they need to get through the world.
Like some people in the disabled community, they struggle to get the necessary equipment. You'd be having access to the technology that they need.
Yep. There are a lot of different programs out there, like Office of Vocational Rehabilitation's one of them in Pennsylvania, that, you know, they can help with a lot of different adaptive equipments. There's something called TechOwl. They're out of Philly, but they help, you know, Pennsylvanians with disabilities all over. They a lot of times can help with, you know, technology. And I think there's also like the Assistive Technology Program Foundation, something like that is what it's called. And they also will help with some of the funding of adaptive equipment. So there are things out there now. Again, is it still a struggle? Of course it is. There's no reason like my wheelchair should be $12,000. There's just no reason, you know, that's expensive. And that's, my insurance will only get me one every 5 years.
Yeah. So hopefully nothing breaks on it.
Yeah. And then when it does, it's a whole process to get the insurance to approve it, to fix it, you know? And a lot of these medical supply companies just don't always care. And thankfully I go through one that does care, Laurel Medical Solutions, and they are more quick with fixing problems than past ones I've used. So are
the issues different, say, for someone who's working and, you know, like they versus someone who's at home and like homebound and depends on Medicaid, you know?
Yeah. So the problem is a lot of people don't understand the complexities of this whole Medicaid thing. A lot of people are like, well, why don't they just work and they can get off of it? And they just, because they don't understand the caveat to all of it, of, you know, no other insurance in this country will pay for attendant care services. So like caregivers coming in your home to help you get ready each day, get a shower, get moved, you know, that no other insurance except for Medicaid will pay for that. There was some legislation put out years back called the Disability Integration Act that would have allowed for private insurance to pay for that, but it never passed.
Well, I'm sure the insurance companies probably didn't want to have to pay for it.
Of course. Yeah, they don't know. So as a result, that's why people are kind of stuck on Medicaid. And so a lot of people will go and try to get a job and, you know, stay under a threshold to still be eligible for their Medicaid. And Pennsylvania has a program called Medical Assistance for Workers with Disabilities. And so then there's another one that just passed like last year, that is success for medical assistance for workers with disabilities for success. So you can earn a little bit more income and still keep mm-hmm. your Medicaid. Yeah. And so that's kind of ultimately the issue. So a lot of people, if you are dependent on caregivers or additional help and you don't have the privilege of family members to help you, or a significant other or whoever, then you end up having a little bit of an issue with, you know, the fact of being able to afford to work. Mm-hmm. You have to be making such a significant amount of money to be able to afford to pay these people if you want to get off the system. So yeah. if you don't need that help, then you kind of have the privilege of being able to work and kind of be like other Americans, you know, with that work as it is with normal insurance, all that stuff. So that's kind of where it differentiates. And there's different programs you can get into, but typically you're always paying attention to how much money you can make. And if you make over that, then you lose your benefits. And now you're paying caregivers out of pocket, and it's a whole process.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's a mess, and you know,
it's all, Yes.
I think the solution is just have universal health care, but
yes, I agree.
Yeah. Who am I? What do I know, though?
I mean, I guess the Affordable Care Act, they did expand Medicaid. And
yes.
I remember.
It made things better, but.
Yes, I do remember. I think it was, wasn't it Tom Corbett when he was governor? Didn't he try to ban the MAUD program or end it?
I'm not entirely sure the history there.
Okay.
But. Wouldn't be shocked.
Yeah, well, I'm sure the governor's race certainly should be is one to be watched between Mastriano and Shapiro. So
yes, certainly. It definitely is, I think, you know, and these are issues that everyday Pennsylvanians don't always think about when they're looking at their elected officials, and they don't realize that these issues can affect them tomorrow.
Yeah.
And that's kind of the situation, you know, disability is, you're not always born with it, you know, you can enter this minority group at any moment. So okay. It's important for everyone to care is what I'm saying. And you should probably, you know, look into your elected officials and see where they stand on disability issues.
Okay. Well, I see we have about 2.5 minutes left. So, I mean, yeah, that's just with my Zoom account. So currently, I guess currently you are studying, you said, I think you said you were studying about disability issues.
Yeah, so I am a senior at William Patterson University of New Jersey with disability studies. So I will have a bachelor's in arts in disability studies, hopefully this coming May.
Okay, well, I look forward to I wish you the best. And
thank you. I appreciate
hopefully maybe you can find some position. Could you see yourself working for OVR? Or?
I'm contemplating going and getting my master's. I'm not entirely sure for OVR work. You have to have your master's. But you know, I'm interested in possibly working with legislators.
Mm-hmm.
You know, helping draft legislate something in that realm of things. So I think they need to have someone who, you know, has the proper knowledge and training and experience to help them draft such legislation. Senator Casey is probably one of the biggest disability allies that we have. That man is phenomenal. He has done so much for disabled people. And, you know, working for someone like him would be a dream come true.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, certainly this was a nice discussion. I hope you found it illuminating. So yeah, we have less than a minute, so I think we may have to say end it, but this will be posted on YouTube and on my website and in the, I guess, Podbean. That's the podcast. So yes.
Sounds good.
to share it. And well, I thank you for your time, and I hope, well, I hope, well, I hope we can stay in touch.
We will. We will. Take care.
Thank you. Have a good day.
You too.
Bye.